started whenever we are back online on Blackboard. You can have that lecture as well. This one I started recording just now. Anyways, but I think you guys can see when I start the recording. So whenever you see that I haven't started the recording, you can remind me. Okay, the last item on this list, as I told you, there are many other items as well. But on this list, the last item is integration of intelligent transportation systems. I have used this term in highway engineering as well, but I will explain you again. Intelligent transportation system means a device which can detect traffic or something related to traffic, and it can take its own decision without any human intervention. Okay, for example, you have a smart signal. So there's a sensor attached with the signal. That sensor senses the traffic, how much traffic is in each direction. On the basis of that, it will change its timing. So no traffic police officer is required, no traffic engineer is required, nobody is required with the signal. The signal is changing the timing on the basis of traffic, on the basis of detection of traffic on its own. Okay, as an example, in our case, by the way, the signal example is also used in Bahrain. And another example which is commonly used in Bahrain and which we are more aware of are the traffic cameras. Cameras which catch you for speeding, cameras which catch you for running the red light. Somebody told me there are cameras which can catch you for using the mobile as well. I hope they are not. But anyways, so these cameras are also part of intelligent transportation system technologies. They do what? They will detect your speed. Then they will catch your license plate number. And then they will basically penalize you. They will send you the fine. They will put a penalty in your record. So who is doing it? The camera is doing it basically. So you can curse the camera as much as you want. So alhamdulillah, there is some benefit out of it. There's been some benefit of these technologies as well. You can curse the camera, you can abuse it. It doesn't matter, okay? But keep in mind, you are just cursing the camera, okay? Not a human being. That has more repercussions, okay? So this is another example of intelligent transportation system technology, something which is detecting traffic and then taking its own decision without human intervention. Now let us talk about integration. We cannot have a whole system working smoothly until these technologies are integrated with each other, okay? So you put a sensor on an intersection, and that sensor is for collecting traffic data. We have talked about traffic studies, right? So in traffic studies, you need, sometimes you put sensors on the road to collect traffic data. So there's a sensor on an intersection which is collecting traffic data, delay, number of vehicles and so on. And it will be used for performance evaluation and facility design and so on. But somebody tells you that this sensor can be connected to a new type of signal, and the signal will be a smart signal to change its timing. So integration would be what? You bring that signal, connect it to the sensor, and now you have a smart signal. Okay, you have you are collecting traffic data as well as you are managing traffic at the same time. Okay, in some countries, they have advanced cameras which can also detect congestion. They can also detect traffic jam and accidents. And then these cameras are attached with an LED board. Okay, so if there is any on some point of the highway, the camera detects an accident, it will send the signal to that LED board, and that LED board will show you the state of the traffic. So it may show you the road is clear, it may show you construction work, it may show you accident ahead. Okay, now how are we doing these things right now? We put these signs, right? These hard, not the boards, the usual signs, warning signs and the orange cones and so on. Okay, so you put these things on the road, and you know, they are doing the same thing for you, but these are not intelligent, right? You go there and you see for yourself that there is construction work, then you come back again with a warning sign and so on. Right? An integration of intelligent transportation systems will integrate these things. and it will make them autonomous. Okay, so camera will detect something going on the road, and it will by itself send the warning to whatever. Okay, so you can attach the camera with an LED board, you can attach it with a website, so the message will show on the, let's say, traffic department website and so on. Okay, another example is working for Causeway. They have an app, and if you are going on the Causeway, you can log into the app and you can see how much will be the travel time right now. This is another sort of an integration. So they have these cameras on the highway, they have the timing which is recorded for each vehicle, and the system is recording everything. Okay, and there are some free apps as well which work on vehicle tracking while you're using the GPS in your mobile or in your vehicle. So vehicle tracking integrated with the app, it gives you the timing. So again, no human intervention. Time is recorded, sent to the website, the user can see the time. Okay, now they are coming at a higher level of integration with the advancement of technology, which is vehicle to vehicle interaction and vehicle to vehicle vehicle to infrastructure interaction. So there are some sensors on the road which are detecting volume and speed and so on. Now imagine if there is a receiver in your vehicle which can take the data from the sensor and show it to you inside your vehicle. So whenever you are in the range of a sensor, you get the data from the sensor, receive it. What is the normal speed on the highway? Is there any accident? Is there some construction work? Where this route is going? And it shows you inside your vehicle. Okay, this is known as vehicle to infrastructure integration. Okay, and then we have vehicle to vehicle communication, and some sort of it is already in place. For example, parking management or collision avoidance or lane management, which you have in your vehicles. So what happens? You are going outside your vehicle, and it shows you a warning that you are going outside your lane. Sorry, not outside your vehicle, you're going outside your lane. So this is vehicle to infrastructure integration. Let's say you are coming very close to another vehicle. So again, you will get the warning. And in some cases, the vehicle may slow down to avoid the accident. Okay, or it may stop to avoid the accident. This is what vehicle to vehicle integration, vehicle to vehicle communication. Okay, why this is not, but this is the, this interaction is not completely in place now. Why? Because we still have cars which do not have these options. Okay, so your car is giving you the warning because you are a big shot. You have purchased a car which is what they call as full option. So you have the full option car. Okay, but that full option car requires a full bucket load of money, so everybody else cannot afford it. So that's why we don't have full integration of vehicle to vehicle and vehicle to infrastructure technology, because the other cars do not have the same options. And as soon as we get to that level, you will start to see more of intelligent transportation system technology integration. Okay, but looking for options, providing options, trying to integrate these technologies is also part of traffic engineering. Now, as a traffic engineer, you are also faced with some modern problems which earlier did not exist. The first problem, which will be related to the transportation demand cycle I showed you. So you keep on providing more infrastructure, and after a few years, the demand increases, and then you go back to the same point. You have the same congestion, same delay, and you have to provide more infrastructure. But you cannot keep on doing that. You have limited land, you have limited budget. So now people are trying to shift their focus from transporting vehicles to transporting people and goods. How we can more efficiently transport people and goods instead of increasing the number of vehicles on the road, or without increasing the number of vehicles on the road. Okay, for example, 50 people going by car. So if each car has two persons, and obviously there are cars which are just have one person. So even if you take a safe measure, a safe number, which is two persons per car, you will need 25 cars. So you need a space for 25 cars. Can I accommodate these 50 people in a lesser space? Yeah, if they are using a bus. Same people on a bus will take space of one bus, which is obviously less than 25 cars. Okay, same thing with the goods deliveries. How can we make them more efficient? Okay, how can we make sure that more goods are being delivered in lesser time and on a smaller vehicles maybe? Okay, that's why we have these delivery services. Now these delivery services are providing you goods at your doorsteps, okay, on a bike. Okay, so one biker is serving like 2-3 persons, 2-3 different houses. If same people come out on the road with their cars on, you can imagine how much space they require. So the focus is now being shifted towards transporting people instead of people and goods, instead of increasing or providing more space for vehicles. Okay, so you have now we try to shift people from cars to their to other modes. So we provide them high speed rail. Okay, we provide them metro services like they have in Dubai and many other countries. Okay, high speed rail, exclusive bus lane. Okay, so the people will not think about using the car, they will think about using the buses, and you will accommodate more people in a smaller space. A thing which is becoming alternative to what we are trying to do with accommodating more people is the advent of the green vehicles. Now, why we call them green vehicles? Because they either they are electric vehicles or they are very fuel efficient. Okay, so they are consuming less fuel. They are not, in some cases their emissions are zero. In some cases their emissions are very low. Okay, so we call them green vehicles. Now, what is happening? These green vehicles are making it easier for the people to afford a vehicle. So you have a green vehicle and you don't have to worry about emissions. So if you are environmentally cautious, environmental sensitive, or pro-environmentalist, as they call it, green vehicles are a response to your worries. You can still own a car and without increasing the emissions and so on. Okay, so people now have alternatives. If I don't care about the environment, I'll go for a normal car. If I care about the environment, I have another car. Okay, so in both cases, I'm increasing traffic. With a green vehicle, also increasing traffic. Okay, and obviously in some countries, electricity is cheaper. So if you don't have fuel, if you have electric vehicle, it becomes cheaper for you. Okay, so green vehicles are also increasing car ownership, number of cars on the road. Then we have increase in fuel prices. Okay, this has been a trend. Last year before Corona, during Corona, it has gone down. But the normal trend was increase in fuel prices. So because of the increasing fuel prices, a lot of things has changed, including the green vehicles, and the cost of running public transport has also increased and so on. Another important factor which has come into play is the security of highway facilities. You know, security from terrorists, security from other law and order situations. You know, in other countries, there are a lot of things, lot of law and order issues which happen on the highways. Okay, so you need to increase the security of the highway facilities. And so for that, you need checkpoints and you need to have barriers and so on. Okay. Now, I think maybe a month ago or a couple of months ago, there was an incident at the Dubai airport as well. Okay, so you need to pay attention to security now. Earlier, that was not a bigger issue. Another important thing which is related to the first point, accommodating more people and goods, is at what time you can allow people and vehicles to enter a congested area. Okay, if you allow everyone who wants to enter the area at a specific time, obviously the congestion will be higher. So you need to divide them. You need to shift them from that time to some other time which has less congestion. Okay, so the demand in that particular hour will go down. The demand for a highway does not remain the same in all the hours of the day. So in some hours of the day it's less, some of the day is more. So if you can shift the demand from high demand hours to less demand hours, so you will have a normalcy in the traffic demand. Okay, so it's not only about how many vehicles or people, it's about how many in a specific time period as well. Now how we can manage that, a very good example for us is the schools we have in the educational area. Before COVID, these schools had their different timings. So some of them were starting at 7, ending at 12, some of them were starting at 7:30, ending at 12:30, and so on. So why to change their timing so that people are coming with some gap toward that area? If all the schools were starting at the same time, imagine what, how much will be the congestion. Even now the congestion, even with the segregated and distributed timing, the congestion was very high, but you can imagine what could have happened if they were all starting and ending at the same time. Okay, so shifting the timing of the facilities in that area. Another thing which is known as toll pricing. So you put a toll or a tax to the people who are trying to enter an area within a specific hour, obviously, and you increase the parking fees in that area for that time. So I know if I come at some other time, I will have to pay less, or I may not have to pay anything. So I may shift my time. So I will not go in the time where everybody is going. I'm going at some other time. So I'm saving my money, and I'm, by not going, I'm also avoiding increase of traffic on the roads. Okay. Similarly, in some countries, they allow high occupancy vehicles. They prefer high occupancy vehicles. What are high occupancy vehicles? Vehicles in which there are more people. So you may have a car, but you are not driving alone. You have 3-4 people with you. So your vehicle will be considered as a high occupancy vehicle. You can travel from a separate lane without paying anything. Okay. So this is how we can shift or reduce the demand. Okay. And all of these things are done for demand management to avoid that cycle. Okay. Then we have problems related to lack of maintenance to allow for reconstruction. Now, normally, when highways are constructed, traffic facilities are constructed, the money comes from the ministry or in some cases from some other financial institution. And those ministries and financial institutions have a bigger budget. Okay, and they do the construction and so on. Then after the facility is constructed, maintenance is allotted to some local department. And that local department has a lesser budget and lesser resources. Okay. These local departments sometimes, or in case of Pakistan, I have seen that, and your book gives the example for USA as well, which has the same issue, that these local departments sometimes defer the maintenance because they know if you don't do the maintenance for so many years, the highway will be reconstructed in any ways, and the reconstruction will not be our bother. So why bother with yearly maintenance? Okay. It happens in Pakistan as well. You construct the highway, it's very smooth, flowless and so on. And with the passage of time, some maintenance is required. They don't do the maintenance because they know after 10 years, they will do the reconstruction. Okay, now what is happening? After 10 years, they will do the reconstruction, obviously. But that reconstruction will be costly, first of all, because you didn't do any maintenance. So instead of 1 BD, you may be spending 3 BD. And secondly, in the years where you did not do the maintenance, the condition of the highway was affecting traffic as well. So in all these years where you did not do the maintenance, you were restricting traffic flow as well. So this is another problem which is faced in many countries, that lack of maintenance restricts or disrupts traffic flow, and it is not being cared for by the local departments because they know that there will be some reconstruction going on. Okay, so these are the modern problems, some present day problems which traffic engineers have to face. Okay. Then there are the reference books which your textbook is using. Okay. Most of them are based from USA, but they are being adopted all around the world. Okay, I have talked about highway capacity manual, and see they have mentioned 2016 manual, so now they are using the 2016 manual. Manual on uniform traffic control devices is an old manual, and both editions are available. Then this is traffic ordinance for USA. This is a traffic engineering handbook. Okay, signal timing manual. And then we have planning handbook, trip generation, parking generation manuals. These manuals are from ITE. The last three are from ITE. Remember, I showed you the definition from ITE, Institute of Transportation Engineers. So they published these manuals as well. And you can see 4th edition, 8th edition, 4th edition. So they do a lot of publishing as well on their own. Okay, so we stop here. I will continue next time. Okay. So I will be willing to take any questions. Okay, are there any questions? Okay, before I move on to the attendance. Yes, Abdullah, something came up and I just pressed okay. I didn't pay attention. Anyways, that student didn't do anything. No problem. Maintenance is allowed. But it's the job of the local department. It's the job of the local department. And local department have less budgets and maybe more activities. So it may not come on their preference. Same preference. Okay, it's allowed. Maintenance is allowed, but they are deferring it. Yes, what's your question? You can, Yeah, open your mic, it will be faster.
All right, doctor. I wanted to ask mainly regarding the way of studying this subject. So yeah. this lecture, and I believe that last lecture were also like more of understanding and more of definitions.
Yeah.
So are they just an introduction, or do we also have these things as a part of our curriculum and our examinations?
These lectures are part of your curriculum, but later on, inshallah, from Thursday or from the next chapter, we'll be, you know, doing some work as well, like numericals, problems, okay? But obviously, in every chapter, you would see some part of it. This is the first chapter, so most of it was in this way, but in the remaining chapters, you would see both aspects, theory as well as numericals, okay? The theory is there. I cannot... because this is the first course of traffic engineering, so I cannot completely eliminate it.
All right. Thank you, doctor.
Yeah, anyone else? Okay, for attendance, what I want you guys to do, because I don't know whether it has started working or not. Okay, it's working now. Okay, so I will take the attendance same way. You raise your hand. Why don't you all raise your hand, and whenever I'm, or let me do it one by one. Elizabeth, please raise your hand. Yeah. Ibrahim, you are here. Okay, fine. Fatma Abbas.
Yes, Victor.
Fatma Abbas.
Yes, Victor.
Okay. Nadine Abdul Salam, you can say yes if you want. I don't know. Nadine Abdul Salam.
Present.
Either you raise your hand or you can open your mic and say yes, if whatever you want. Nadine Abdul Salam, not here. I think I saw her name. Zena Abdul Hadi. Zainab Abdul Hadi. Okay, Nadine. Okay, Zainab, both of you. Okay, fine. Ali Abdul Hussain. Ali Abdul Hussain. Yeah, you can lower your hand. Ali Abdul Hussain. not here.
Yes, doctor. Yes.
Hakim Abdullah.
Ali Abdul Hussein, doctor. Ali Abdul Hussein.
Ali Abdul Hussein is here.
Yes. Yes. Not.
You are here. Okay, Ali Abdullah. Hakima and Ali Abdullah. Okay, fine. Hakima, Ali Abdullah. Okay. Dulba Abdullah. Okay, you are here. Maryam Abdullah. Maryam Abdullah. Okay. Latifa Abdullah. Okay. Fawz Ahmed. Okay. Zainab Ahmed. Okay. Abdullah Ali. You are here. Okay, fine. Asil, you took the control from me, huh? You are here. Okay. Laila Ali. Laila Ali. Okay. Isra Ali. Okay. Amal Fanhur. Amal Fanhur. Okay. Zahra Hassan. Zahra Hassan.
Yes, doctor.
Okay. Abdurrahman Haji. Okay. Zahra Khalid.
Yes, doctor.
Zainab Mansoor. Okay. Hamad Muhammad. Okay. Muhammad Muhammad. Muhammad Muhammad with the picture. Okay, Muhammad Noman. Okay. Nujood Ahmed. Nujood Muhammad. Sorry. Okay. Muhammad Muhammad without a picture. Muhammad Muhammad. The other one. Let me. Muhammad Muhammad. I don't know who is that. Abdullah Muhyiddin. Abdullah Muhyiddin. Okay. Ala Mustafa. Ala Mustafa. Okay. Majd Mustafa. Majd Mustafa. Ali Noman. Ali Noman. Amna Rafiq. Amna Rafiq.
Doctor?
Amna Rafiq. Yeah.
I am Muhammad Nu'man. Without picture.
There are two Muhammad Muhammad. I don't know which one are you.
Yeah, I
which one are you? Without. Are you this one without the picture?
Yeah.
And who is that one with the picture?
I don't know.
You don't know?
Yeah.
Amna Rafiq is not here. Okay. Dua Salman. Dua Salman. Okay. Abu Bakr Tahir. Ali Yusuf. Ali Yusuf. Not here. Okay, I'm calling out the absentees again. Ali Yusuf, Amna Rafiq, Ali Noman, Majid Mustafa. If you are one of these, so open your mic and tell me. And there's no Muhammad with that picture. Huh? This guy is not here, Muhammad.
I'm here, Doctor.
So there is Muhammad Noman and you are Muhammad?
Muhammad Usam.
Okay. Okay, done. Thank you. Sorry for taking more time. So see you on Thursday, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum.